all mathematics.
Mighty most deaf.
It's simple mathematics.
Check it out.
I'll revolve around science.
What are we talking about here?
What is up, everybody? It is Jacob, aka Pick Management, here with the Prince of Picks, my new co-host, Payam. What's up, buddy? Welcome to the Sports Betting Insiders presents NBA Betting Insiders. We're going to be bringing you the best NBA picks on a daily basis. You're going to get our best bets and some picks for prize picks, which I know everybody loves, right here on NBA Betting Insiders on the new Sports Betting Insiders YouTube page. Payam, what's up, buddy? Welcome to our first show. How you doing?
What's up, Jacob? Thanks for having me on, man. I'm looking forward to doing this show with you. Been a big fan of yours for a while, so it's exciting to get into the gambling podcast show, and I'm really looking forward to it. For those of you that don't know me, kind of an introduction about myself. My name is Payam, aka Prince of Picks. Some of you may know me as Johnny Football from Juan Perez's Radio Roulette Show. Others of you might know me as Lock It Up Sports from over my 750 TikTok subscribers. So I got a couple aliases running out there. Little bit about myself. Grew up a Suns fan. I've been a Suns fan my whole life. Kind of got a little funny story regarding my background. When I was in fourth grade, I had a big whiteboard on my bedroom wall. And every morning I would check SportsCenter for the Phoenix Suns score. Okay, because you gotta remember back then it was the 90s, and so we didn't have internet. So the only way you could check the score is if you didn't watch the game live, you have to wait till the next morning until the game they show the highlights on SportsCenter. And that's the only way you could check the score. So I'd get up every morning before I got on the school bus, I'd be watching SportsCenter, and I'll wait for that Suns highlight to come on. And every game that they played, when they showed the score, I wrote down every single Suns score. Okay. For the entire season, and I also wrote down the leading rebounder, points, and assists. Okay, I did that for all 82 games of the season. All right, and then at the end of the season, I totaled out their averages for their points scored, points against, and all the statistical leaders for the Suns throughout the season. So I say all that to say that I've been a fan of basketball. I've had a deep passion for basketball and numbers and statistics for a very long time. I grew up a dual sport athlete, played both basketball and soccer. Competitively played it before high school, during high school, during college, and after college as well. I actually won a 3v3 national championship in soccer in 2002. Like I said, I've been playing competitively, played a lot against a lot of former D1 guys, AAU guys, guys that played overseas for a little bit, maybe some high school standouts and whatnot. So I've been playing competitively for a really long time. Both sports, and I was doing that up until about 5 years ago when I was diagnosed with two sports hernias and sciatic nerve damage in my lower back. And so that was kind of the end of my athletic career competitively, but what I did was I turned my passion that I had for playing sports competitively, and I turned that passion into betting sports competitively. And so I've been giving out picks ever since. Last year in the NBA, we had a 54% win rate by the end of the season. So we had a profitable year, plus 3% on the top. And then during the conference finals, Eastern Conference, Western Conference, and NBA finals, we went for a staggering 18-2 record. Okay, so that was a pretty historic record. So I say that to say I know basketball. I've been around the game for a long time. The thing with me, if I would describe myself as a bettor, I'm more of a conservative, risk advert bettor. I don't really throw things at the wall to see what sticks. I'm more of a type that, if I put my name on it, it matters. And so I'm going to be, very, very judicious about what kind of picks I give and what kind of plays I give. At the end of the day, I want us all to be profitable, not to be millionaires. Right. So, I'm not going to give these crazy wild bets, but, I do want us all to stay in the green. And so that's my goal for everyone out there watching us, is that every day you watch this show, that you end up being profitable by the end of the night. So other than that, man, that's all I got. Like I said, I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to be on the show. I'm looking forward to doing the picks with you, and I'm looking forward to making money with everyone.
Yeah, absolutely. You guys heard it here first. Prince of Picks, been handicapping basketball since the fourth grade. So, he knows what he's talking about. handicapping games before you get on the bus in the morning. It's some serious dedication. So you know he's going to make you some money. You know, so let's get dig into it. And, you know, it's a light slate today, Monday. It's a two-game quarterfinals NBA in-season tournament. First time ever elimination game, Boston Celtics versus Indiana Pacers and the Sacramento Kings versus the New Orleans Pelicans. Let's dig right into it. For me, Boston Celtics versus the Pacers, it's a crazy game. You know, I wish Tyrese Halliburton was full health for this game. I think it would make it way more competitive and an easy match. That's never going to be an easy matchup for the Celtics, but an easier one with a 100% Halliburton. He is suffering from an upper respiratory infection. He's a game-time decision, and that's going to affect a lot of the play in this game. I do say that because Pacers, pace of play, offense, number one in the NBA. We all know an over for a Pacers game is like a gimme right now. The Celtics, number one defense. They shut dudes down. Even without Porzingis right now, they're just on fire. Al Horford still maniac over there. Whole team still doing what they're supposed to do. And, you know, I think the Pacers wish they would have faced anybody else in this tournament right now, you know, because they're going to play this like it's their NBA finals. The Celtics may not take this game as seriously. It's kind of like you see in an English, like, FA Cup for, like, Man City. You know what I mean? The in-season tournament isn't the most important thing for them right now. Their eyes are on the playoffs and the finals. While the Pacers understand this may not be their season, but this in-season tournament is going to be their championship. So they're really pushing for some silver. And, you know, when it comes to picks for this game, you know, I think I might take the Pacers on the points. I might take a look at maybe buying a couple points up, actually, in this one. I do like the over. I think over in this game is going to be a gimme. Even though the Boston defense is number one in the league, they might be able to shut down the Pacers a little bit. I think the Pacers' pace of play is going to allow the Celtics to play a little bit more freely, score a lot of points. I'm going to be taking a look at their team total over, which is currently set at 124. I think this could be one of the highest scoring games for the Celtics of the season, just because I think the Pacers are going to leave it all on the floor. And that could leave things open for the Celtics to score a lot. You know, like I said, the Pacers are going to be treating this like their finals, but sometimes they come up against a buzzsaw, and with or without Porzingis, and even without the, you know, total, you know, determination to win the in-season tournament, you know, I think the Celtics, you know, of course, would still like to win that too, and would love to send the Pacers home. So that's what I got for this game. Prince of Picks, Payam, Johnny Football, whatever you call yourself these days, somebody. But Payam, what you got for this game?
Yeah, I'm with you on that. On the Pacers taking this a little more serious than the Celtics, for sure. I'm on board with that. Like you said, Celtics are definitely a championship contender this year. Pacers, most would say, are not. So yeah, for sure, I could see them taking this game with a lot more intensity than maybe Boston. Not to say that Boston won't try, but you know, push come to shove, I think Indiana might make those plays at the end of the game. Plus, they're at home, which is a huge advantage. Indiana is a machine offensively. I mean, they're putting up numbers, the historic numbers that we haven't seen since maybe the mid-2000s, my Phoenix Suns back in the mid-2000s with Mike D'Antoni, those run-and-gun Suns. And even those teams weren't putting up the kind of numbers that the Pacers are putting up. So it's staggering when you see a score of 135 to 130 and you don't think twice because it's the Pacers, right? So they're just an absolute machine offensively. And at the same time, they're giving up points at the same rate that they're scoring. So overs in Pacers games are almost like a cash cow. I'm all over the 242.5 for the total. We get that at minus 108 right now. I'm also on the Pacers team total over 118.5. Got that at minus 110. And then Celtics also over 124.5. I got that one at minus 115. If you parlay all three of those, you can get it around plus 190. I would bet them individually and parlay it. To be honest with you, 13 of the last 15 Pacers games have gone game total over 241. Eight of the last 11 Pacers home games have gone over 241. 78% of Pacers games have gone team total over 118.5 this season. And I mean, you think about it, the Pacers just put up 130, over 130, twice against the Miami Heat, who most would consider to be a defensive culture team, right? There's this thing about Heat culture, and what does Heat culture pride themselves on? Defensively, right? They put up 130 twice against them, right? So this team, I mean, there's nothing that can stop them except themselves, right, offensively. And I think without Porzingis being there for Boston, I think it's just going to be free range for Indiana offensively. So I love all those team totals over for Indiana. And then, like I said, on the opposite side, the Pacers rank 29th in defensive rating. They rank 30th in points per points against, which is dead last. They give up 125.9 points per game. They rank first in points per game, 128.8. So, again, high-scoring games are almost a lock, a cash cow for these Pacers games. Boston ranks 8th in points per game, so they're in the top 10. So even more of a reason why you would take the Boston team total. They did put up 155 against them earlier. I think it was in early November. Boston, now that game was at home in Boston, and they blew them out. They blew them the hell out. But it's different in Indiana. Indiana plays better at home. And I think with this being an NBA Cup, I think you can kind of throw that blowout out the window a little bit. I think the intensity levels will be raised, like you said before. I think more so with Indiana than with Boston. So those are the team totals I would like in those games. And then I don't know if you want to get into the player props for this game or.
Yeah. Let us know what you got. What do you have for player props?
Okay. So what I got. So if I were to pick two, you know, what I'll try to do is I'll pick a player prop for each team. So that way, if you're rooting for one or the other, you have something to go for.
Just so all the listeners know, I'm going to jump in real quick here. We are going to start putting together some stuff for Prize Picks. We know it's bigger for you guys. You know, while, you know, we both are good on player props individually, we don't typically play on Prize Picks. So we are going to start playing on Prize Picks. We're going to start sharing those with you because if we're winning on the sports book, all we got to do is put them on Prize Picks and we're going to start smashing there too. So Prize Picks, look out. We are coming for you.
For sure. So on Boston side, I like Jason Tatum over 29.5. He had 30 in their last game. And there's really nobody on Indiana who can match up with him defensively. I mean, he should have free range. You know, if Haliburton plays, you know, he's going to either be on Jaylen Brown or Tatum. I would think most likely he'll be on Jaylen Brown. So that's going to free up Tatum to just get whatever he wants. I think over 29.5 is a great play for him. And then on the Indiana side, I actually like Obi Toppin over 3.5 rebounds. I don't think Boston's second unit, they're very good at rebounding. They're not very good at rebounding, I should say. They struggle on the rebounds in general. And especially their second unit, they don't really have anyone who can come in and compete with Obi Toppin. And if this game ends up being a blowout like last time, I could see Obi Toppin getting more minutes in the game, which would give him more opportunity to get that over 3.5 rebounds. Indiana as a team is fourth in rebounds in the league, and Boston is 14th in rebounds. So you have the team advantage right there. And then, like I said, I think Obi Toppin could be in a good position to get over 3.5. That's a small number. I could see him possibly getting that. What do you like, Jacob?
For sure. You know, mine's going to be dependent on if he plays. But if Haliburton's in, I'm going to be taking his under in this one. You know, I just think that with the upper respiratory infection and the pace of play and what the kind of defense. Now, I will say, playing against a team that is really good defensively is just so much more taxing as an up-paced offensive team, and then having to play such as a hard defensive team, it just makes the game so much more difficult for the up-tempo team. As a former basketball player, I'll say I know that from experience. It just makes everything more difficult, and when you're having trouble breathing, it's gonna make that, you know, even that much harder. So you know, and from what I have heard. You know, this is the Sports Betting and NBA Betting Insiders. I did hear a little birdie this morning tell me that if he plays, he will be watched closely, and it's not a guarantee that he will be playing a full game or anything close to it. Right now, he's at over 27.5 points for this game. I think maybe we see 20 out of him in maybe, you know, 27 minutes. Half a game, something like that. I don't think he gets anywhere near a full game. So that's what I'm on for this. We'll have more. We're gonna get you guys at 25x hit. But for today, we just got three for this first game. I don't know if Payam has any for the next one. But moving on to the late game, 10 p.m. tonight, New Orleans Pelicans taking on the Sacramento Kings. Let's say it again. New Orleans Pelicans taking on the Sacramento Kings tonight at 10 p.m. You know, my guy, New Orleans Pelicans and the Sacramento Kings. You know, I'm not really a Kings fan. My cousin has season tickets. He sits right behind the basket, and I hate the Kings for it because he is there at all their games. But I will say, I should have brought him out for this. My one collector pair of sneakers are the Zion 2s that I have in a box downstairs. They are crisp. They're tight. I only take them out on special occasions, but they're like – the hottest sneakers I've ever seen in my life. They're Jordans. It's the only pair of Jordans I've ever bought in my life, and they're Zions. So
I'm jealous.
Yeah, I am a little. What would you call it? I will side with the Pelicans a little bit more here because I'm such a Zion fan. But what I will say for a little futures for this, I do like Zion to win in-season tournament MVP. That is a serious bet that I like here. He has been dominant in the games that he's played. He took it to LeBron the other day. I would like seeing that. And I think if they could take down the Kings here, I really think that they're going to, it's going to come down to the best player and the best player on the best team in this tournament. I think just for simplicity's sake, I think that's how they're going to pick the MVP. New Orleans ranks just 19th in offense. But they posted 119.6 rating in the past 2 weeks. That's got them up to 10th place in their offensive rating. And one thing to know about New Orleans, which is weird, their individual defensive ratings suck. But as a team, it elevates for some reason their defensive rating. So it's a weird stat. I'm going to clear that up and I'm going to post about it. There's going to be a little breakdown on my social later. So make sure to check that out at Pick Management. But the Pelicans defense is a little funky, and I think that's going to let the Kings score here. So I think one thing we are going to see is a high scoring game. The Kings have put together a string of impressive wins lately. They had a dramatic home win against the Warriors just the other day. They just took down the Nuggets. De'Aaron Fox has been playing like a man possessed lately. I really like what he's been doing. In the past two games between the Pelicans and the Kings, we've seen Fox score 26 and 14 points. So if you're looking towards player props in this matchup, I would be looking towards maybe a Fox over, maybe a PRA over, something like that for him. He is averaging 27.7 points per game. And his current prop line is at 27.5. So your books have it spot on. But will the Kings be able to take down the Pelicans and Zion in this game? It's yet to be seen. Okay, so here's the stat about their defense. The Pelicans' defense passes the eye test, and the advanced stats don't show a lot of individual defensive prowess. The only positive defenders by defensive estimated plus-minus, a stat found on dunks and threes, are Herb Jones plus one and Dyson Daniels plus 1.5. That means they rank in the 85th and 93rd percentile. Every other Pelicans defender is a negative DEPM. That's a defensive estimated plus minus. Instead of individual prowess, their defensive improvement is coming from a concerted emphasis on crashing the boards and forcing turnovers. So that means one-on-one defenders suck and you can burn them. But as a team, when you put that ball up, everyone's crashing the boards and they're going to be able to force turnovers, which puts them in a different position when you know that you can count on your team to have your back. I think that plays a little differently here. That is from the Action Network, a great breakdown for their in-season game. They have some great, really in-depth stats over there from their pro network. So with all that being said, I know you guys are here for the picks. I am going to be on the Pelicans money line. I'm taking them straight up, plus 135 here. I think they're going to advance. I like them to win the in-season tournament. I think we're going to see a Pelican-Celtics final, and I like the over here as well. Payab, what do you have for the Pelicans versus Kings matchup?
Yeah, so to allude to your defensive ratings for the Pelicans, I think that also might speak to maybe they're just a little bit better on help defense and defensive rotations. Sure. As opposed to individual defense, you know, which would kind of speak to why, you know, their metrics are so low individually. One bet I guess I would maybe counter on you, or it depends on a caveat, is De'Aaron Fox's total points. I looked at an injury report. I believe Jose Alvarado is cleared to play. I don't think there's any injury designation for him. And depending on how many minutes he gets, if there's one player in the NBA that I don't want to go against defensively, it would be Jose Alvarado. If he's on your team, you love him. If he's not on your team, you can't stand him. He's the new pest of the NBA. Defensively, he just gets after it. And like I said, depending on how many minutes he gets, I don't know what their rotation is going to look like in terms of who's getting the minutes. If I was New Orleans, I would consider playing him a little bit more than normal just because he has an opportunity to slow down De'Aaron Fox. Nobody's going to stop De'Aaron Fox. He's a machine offensively. And not to say that the over can't hit, but I think it would, the only caveat to that would be if Jose Alvarado gets some extended playing time, I could see the potential for De'Aaron Fox possibly going under. I know that's not a very favorable bet, but you know, maybe not a popular bet, but it's something that I would at least.
But could consider. Be the sharp one. Hey, that's why we're both here. You know, that's why we give people both sides of the coin. You know what I mean?
So something to think about. But other than that, there's honestly not too much I like in this game. It's kind of a toss up for me. The both teams are you know they're both pretty good, in terms of you know all their metrics and whatnot. I do like the Kings over 119.5. I don't know if that line has gone up. I locked in the bet last night, but I would still take it even if it's, you know, over one, you know, maybe 120. Probably wouldn't go over 121. But at 119, I like it. That has hit 56% of the time this season. It's hit 62% with the Kings being at home. So I like that bet. I also like the Pelicans. I'm sorry, the whole game, not the Pelicans, but the actual game under 235. That has hit 67% of the time in all Pelicans games this season. And, you know, with the intensity levels being raised on both sides, I think both teams kind of match up pretty evenly with each other. So I see the opportunity for maybe some more defensive intensity. Mike Brown, believe it or not, the head coach of the Kings, he actually does believe in defensive principles. Even though last year the Kings were one of the highest scoring teams and also gave up some of the most points in the NBA. But he is considered to be a defensive coach. And if you look at the Pelicans, when they gave the, you know, their kind of coming to fame moment was in their playoff series a couple years ago against the Suns, my Suns. And the reason that they stayed in that series was defensively. Defensively, they got after it. And so both coaches actually lean more defensively. So I could see the possibility of the game going under. Like I said, it's hit 67% of the time in all Pelicans games this season. So the numbers would, you know, sort of support that. Another bet I like would be Kings first quarter minus one. You get that at minus 105. Kings are ranked number 6 in the NBA in first quarters right now. Pelicans are ranked number 24. So Pelicans traditionally start out pretty slow in the first quarter. So I like that bet, especially with the Kings being at home. I could see them getting off to a hot start. And then for our prize picks, player props, for Sacramento, I would like Malik Monk over 2.5 threes. I got that at plus 124 last night. I'm not sure if that number has been updated. He has hit 47% from three over his last 10 games. And he kind of turns up when the lights are the brightest. He's one of those players that doesn't shy away from the moment. He embraces the moment. And especially with this being an NBA Cup quarterfinal, at home in front of the home fans, I could see him hitting that with ease, to be honest with you. So I really like that bet a lot. And then on New Orleans side, again? Malik Monk over 2.5 threes.
All right.
So that's one of my favorite bets of the day, I would say. And then on New Orleans side, I like Jonas Valanciunas over 9.5 rebounds. He's averaged 10 rebounds over his last 10 games. And I think he can hold it down against Sabonis down low in the post. Now, I would say, you know, with Sabonis, he's going to be battling with either Valanciunas or Zion on the rebounds. But my opinion of Zion is he's more effective when he has the ball in his hands as opposed to when he doesn't. So he can kind of get a little lost. He can get a little lazy, for lack of a better word, when he doesn't have the ball. So I don't know if his intensity level is always going to be there on the rebounding side of it. Whereas Valanciunas, if he's not rebounding, there's no point in being in the game. So he has no choice but to go for the rebounds because he doesn't provide anything else. So I like Valanciunas over 9.5 rebounds. I think that could be a pretty solid play. Those would be the two picks that I got for player picks. What do you got?
All right. Well, for this game, I do not have any player props for this one. We're going to be coming out with more of those later on. We're going to shoot for this to be a daily episode. We really like to get you guys some great NBA content on a daily basis, get this out in the early afternoon. Make sure to check lineups before games, always the rule for NBA. So usually you don't put these bets in until later, so you'll be able to get the official plays. You can check it out on my Twitter at Pick Management or the Prince of Picks Twitter at PyamM1. That's PayamM1. He might be changing his socials up. He said he might mention doing something like that. But until then, that's where you can find him. Make sure to go to our YouTube. It is Sports Betting Insiders on YouTube. Make sure to hit that like and subscribe. The Betting the Pitch show, the soccer show from Sports Betting Insiders, is going to be doing a giveaway for the MLS Cup. You can win some swag from the MLS Cup champions. Columbus Crew is going to be one of those teams in that game. So make sure to check that out. Make sure to hit up the socials. Make sure to find the Pick Management Discord, free to join. You get extra picks from me, from the Prince of Picks. Some other great cappers are in there. Payam, what do you got for the folks to say goodbye?
Yep, like you said, you can follow me on Twitter at PayamM1. You can also follow me on TikTok at Lock It Up Sports. I post a majority of my plays on there, actually. So you can follow me there. And those both will be getting updated soon. I just ran into a little technical issue, so I got to wait for a few weeks before I can update it according to the guidelines of both platforms. But those will be updated soon. In the meantime, Lock It Up Sports on TikTok. That's all I got. So,
all right. Make sure to hit that like, hit that follow, and we will see you later.
It's all mathematics. Mighty most deaf. It's simple mathematics.